Hello, welcome to my channel, Medicine with Dr. Moran. Yesterday in the New England Journal of Medicine, there was a peer-reviewed research study on COVID-19 vaccine effectiveness in all of New York State. They used data from over 8.6 million adults in New York State, and they wanted to evaluate how effective their vaccines were against COVID-19 infections, as well as COVID-19 hospitalizations. Now, they looked at groups that were defined by which vaccine they received, as well as the age of the person receiving it, the time they were fully vaccinated. All of those factors were looked at to ascertain the efficacy. Now, here is the study. As always, there's a link to the study in the description below. The purpose of the study was simple. It was to see how well the vaccines work protecting against COVID-19 infection and COVID-19 hospitalization in New York State. Recently, as the authors of the study point out, the FDA in the US has recommended expanded eligibility for booster doses of the vaccines for everybody over the age of 18. Now, these recommendations are being made despite gaps in data regarding vaccine efficacy in groups according to age, time of vaccination, and vaccine product. The investigators looked at four databases to construct a huge cohort of adults 18 years of age or older residing in New York State. They then looked at all vaccination data and hospital data for the entire state. In total, there were 8.69 million adults in the analysis, of which 5.3 million were vaccinated and 3.1 million who were not fully vaccinated. Of the vaccinated people, 49 got Pfizer, 41% Moderna, and 10% J&J. Now, during follow-up, there were 38,419 cases of COVID and 2,354 hospitalization in the fully vaccinated group, and 112,446 cases of COVID and 12,123 hospitalizations in unvaccinated people. Now, you can see that there were significantly more COVID in the unvaccinated group and significantly more hospitalization in the unvaccinated group, even without adjusting the numbers per 1,000 persons. As well as the numerical results, they made graphs of their results. One set of graphs was vaccine effectiveness against laboratory-confirmed COVID illness, and the other set looked at vaccine effectiveness against hospitalization, as I mentioned previously. First, I want to talk about the graphs for vaccine effectiveness against COVID. Now, this is the graph for the 18 to 49 years of age group. And on this graph, which is the Pfizer graph for this age group, there are three lines on the graph. There's an orange line if you were fully vaccinated in January, February, a red line if you're fully vaccinated in March, and a blue line if you're fully vaccinated in April. Now, around each one of these three lines is the same color of the line, but shaded, which indicates a 95% confidence intervals around the average number, which is the line itself. On the horizontal or x-axis is the time starting in May and going to the end of August 2021. Now, the following graphs for 18 to 49 years of age people all have the same legend with the same colors for Moderna vaccine, which is graph B, and the J&J graph, which is graph C. As you can see with Pfizer and Moderna, the numbers start around 95%, but by the end of the study, which was August, the effectiveness against COVID-19 illness had dropped to 65 to 75% for Pfizer and 75 to 85% for Moderna. You will also note that the people that were fully vaccinated in January and February, which is the orange line, had the lowest vaccine efficacy. Now, this is efficacy against a lab-positive COVID-19 infection. Lastly, for J&J, you can see that there was much more significant lowering of vaccine efficacy compared to the other two mRNA vaccines. This is primarily due to the fact that this was a single-dose vaccine, and we knew that two vaccinations may be needed for better effectiveness based on the single dose phase 3 trial that they presented. Now, the graphs for the greater than 65 years of age. Again, Pfizer's on the left, Moderna in the middle, and J&J on the right. Now, no matter what age group you look, there's slow fall in protection against COVID no matter which vaccine was given, with a much greater fall with the J&J vaccine. Even amongst Pfizer and Moderna, there was much less of a drop-off with Moderna, but the numbers are essentially similar across all age groups, with the biggest drop-off for those people who were vaccinated early on in January and February. Next, I want to show you the graphs of protection against hospitalization, which would be severe disease, which is really what we're most interested in. The graphs are similar to the ones I've just shown you, but instead of shading the confidence intervals, they chose to represent them as bars on the graph because the numbers are very similar no matter when the person became fully vaccinated. To start off, here's the 18 to 49 year old group. Here you can see for Pfizer and Moderna, they're relatively straight lines with numbers between 90 and 98%. The numbers are similar for J&J, although one of the data points is only at 50%, but you'll see there's quite a wide confidence interval because they only had a small number of people in that group, and the number is likely higher than 50%. They just didn't have enough people. As you will see with the single J&J, the protection against hospitalization in the groups over 50, which I'll present in a minute, actually were 80 to 90%, which of course is lower than the mRNA vaccines, but still highly protective against hospitalization. In this group, you can see with the Pfizer vaccine, which is the one on the left, for people fully vaccinated in January, February, which again is the orange line, there was a slow reduction in effectiveness going out to August, where protection against hospitalization started to dip down into the high 80s. There was a much less significant drop with Moderna if you compare the middle graph, Moderna graph, to the Pfizer on the left. In this study, as well as many others, you can see that the Moderna vaccine performed better. This may be because the Moderna vaccine has 100 micrograms of messenger RNA in it versus 30 micrograms in the Pfizer vaccine, but more likely it's the fact that the Moderna vaccine actually was given 4 weeks apart as opposed to the 3 weeks with Pfizer. I've spoken numerous times on my channel the importance of the timing between these two vaccinations. An 8 week interval gives better immunity than a 3 to 6 week interval. I repeat, an 8 week interval gives better immunity than 3 to 6 weeks. Multiple studies from the UK and Canada have shown that there's no benefit to having an interval longer than 8 weeks, but 8 weeks is clearly better than 3 to 6. It wasn't clear initially when the vaccines were first administered what the optimal time frame was, but there are immunological reasons which I won't go into on this video as to why 8 to 12 weeks is better than 3 to 4 weeks. And it was the reason why I spaced my own injections out 3 months apart, even though I was asked to come back 3 weeks later. I have made two videos on my channel about this particular topic. Now, getting back to the paper, in the discussion section, the authors did indicate that changes in prevention policies and behaviors in vaccinated people could have contributed to more frequent COVID infections as time went on. You may know in May, New York State did adopt revised CDC guidelines for fully vaccinated people, which would have reduced mask wearing, distancing, and other prevention practices, and this could have increased exposure amongst vaccinated people and thus lowered vaccine effectiveness. Also, the presence of Delta variant, given its increased transmissibility, would certainly have played a role in this as well. The findings of the study aligns with the CDC recommendations for mRNA vaccines, Pfizer and Moderna. That is that a third injection in people over 65 is reasonable. The study author's conclusions, and here they are, suggested a focus on the third vaccination if you're older than 65 and it's warranted with only limited need for booster expansion beyond that age group for the purposes of trying to reduce severe COVID-19. In other words, reducing hospitalizations. It goes without saying that there are other groups, such as the immunocompromised group, that would need a third injection. Often the first or second injection does not have much of an effect because of their immunocompromised state. You might wonder whether this study looked at who ended up in the hospital and what kind of comorbidities they had. It did not. I recently made a video on who dies fully vaccinated due to breakthrough infections from another study. This is obviously important to know because we want to target those people with a third dose. Now, as you might expect in the video, as I mentioned, it comes down to age as well as comorbidities, and obesity is a huge factor. With many people in the Western world over the age of 18 now getting a third vaccination, it will be interesting to see what the benefit is in different groups of people, particularly the very low-risk people who are in the 18 to 30 group. It'll also be interesting to look at vaccine side effects as people get their third booster. Thanks for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I hope you enjoyed my presentation. I'm Dr. Keith Moran, and remember, get healthy and stay healthy.